Okay. So how many of you have already heard this presentation? If none of you have, then it's worth it. Otherwise, it's revision for you and revision for the nth time for me. So let's go through this because nothing much has changed in the last year or so. So let me begin with a scenario. So small people, IFS, and people expansion devices, small things which we can take note of as we go. Let's look at this particular case, and this is what we would call an averagely dilated pupil, and which probably is not a very big concern for seasoned phaco surgeons. Not many of you would choose to probably use any pupil expanders or iris hooks in this. Now, when I was just doing that viscoelastic injection, I noticed a bit of iris prolapse, and so I chose to use a pupil expander. And well, we did have a nice expanded pupil, but let's see what happened somewhere down the line. Well, I have an iris prolapsing through the side port, and that's making life difficult, despite the pupil expander. And somewhere down the here, we have already got iris prolapsing through the main incision. So what I'm trying to drive at is IFS is a very different animal, and pupil expanders or iris hooks really don't do much about to prevent the iris prolapse. What they do is give you a constant pupil size so that you can work safely and have constant visibility. IFS is very common in India, and that has been proven in this paper. The incidence is in fact much higher than the Western world, and hypertension is an important risk factor along with other things. So this is a chart which tells us that no amount of history taking is going to be foolproof, and every alternate patient is a potential IFS candidate. We've all often talked about what is a safe pre-op pupil size. Well, this is a paper published in 2011, and which says that 7 millimeter or smaller pupil, the risk of IFS exists irrespective of alpha blockers. So like I said, iris hooks and pupil expander do not eliminate the risk of iris prolapse, but they do provide a dilated pupil providing visibility and safety, and that's where is their role. So we need to understand that there are basically two types of small pupils. There are the rigid, non-elastic small pupils and the elastic IFS pupil. The two need to be dealt very differently. They're two different ball games. So let's look at IFS. Now this is a what we got grade one IFS, where there's just a little bit of undulation of that iris over there, and this is really not a problem. But this is a full-blown iris where you have IFS, where you have the pupil coming down on you. Nothing wrong with the flow rate, but the pupil just chooses to come down. And it's elastic pupil. You can again inflate the anterior chamber, and it will. These are very old videos, so you'll have to bear with me for the quality. And in fact, this was much before IFS was probably recognized. And then we have a situation where I've used iris hooks, and even before I completed my capsular excess, there was so much of iris prolapse and it reposited time and again that I had a frayed iris by the time I got my phaco probe in. So that's how, that's the entire spectrum of IFS. IFS is very unpredictable, and we need to brace ourselves and be prepared for any situation. So, and more importantly, tamsulosin or other factors which cause IFS, and tamsulosin particularly, even if you stop tamsulosin, it really makes no difference. The features of the iris remain the same, and it could be 3 to 7 days of starting tamsulosin, or even after stopping tamsulosin, you would have the effect. So these are all the complications that you can have, and you could all prevent a lot of this by using iris hooks or pupil expansion devices. So the bottom line is that pupil stretching is not effective in IFS. You must remember that. You'll stretch and it'll come back again. So you need a device in place to hold it so that that pupil does not come down smaller than what you want to work. There are the various devices, the iris hooks, the Mulligan ring, and the BHEX pupil expander. This is a brief overview of all the devices that we have. This is the APX ASIA pupil expander, but it's a bit bulky device. It's a double iris hook. This is the Expand NT iris speculum. Again, it's got a biplanar device, and it snags the incision. It's difficult to insert and remove, a bit traumatic. So they put it through a injector, which kind of helped a little bit. But then again, still, it's a bit jerky and not so controlled. So really didn't, wasn't so really so impressive. And this is the eye ring, which has been there, but still a bit bulky. The vertical profile is quite a lot, 1.4 millimeters, and that where the corners rest is the mid-peripheral antechamber, where the AC is going to be pretty shallow. It's going to be 1.5, 3, 2 millimeters anyway, and that would be a touch and go. This is the Canabra ring, difficult to use again. It's a PMMA device, has specific indications, can't use it universally. Then we come to the BHEX pupil expander, which is what we've been having in the last 2 years over here in India. It's a hexagon with notches and flanges, alternate flanges being tucked under the pupil margin, and the notches engaged to the pupil margin, which provides pupil expansion. So we'll skip that. Yeah. So how it differs from the Mulligan ring or the eye ring is that there's entirely new concept. The device is in a single plane. It's a very thin device. It's 0.075 millimeters. While the Mulligan ring or the eye ring or all devices are biplanar devices which engage the pupil margin by the cup-like feature on the side of the device. Here, the entire device is in the same plane and the iris kind of bends at the notches. So the iris can be bent harmlessly and reversibly, and that does that makes the insertion and removal of the device very easy because that's a single plane device, so it walks in and walks out of the incision. A few pearls with the BHEX. You must, I would urge you to watch videos. There are plenty of them on the YouTube, instruction videos as well, because the device looks so simple. It's no rocket science, but when you start off, you may have a little bit of a learning curve, so watching a few videos would be useful. It's very important to keep the anterior chamber slightly shallow. The standard our protocol is we, as soon as we start the case, we inject a lot of viscoelastic and inflate the anterior chamber to get a slightly wider pupil. But that can be counterproductive because the iris gets plastered. So overfilling pushes the iris against the lens capsule, and that reduces the space for tucking the flanges. That works for all devices, even iris hooks. So when you push viscoelastic, the iris is getting plastered. So it'd rather serve better to use a bit of viscoelastic under the pupil margin to lift it off a little. So that keeps room for your iris hooks or Mulligan ring or eye ring or the BHEX. So whatever you use, you need the bowing of the iris. So this is how we do it. A little bit of viscoelastic in the central area so there is no touch over there. And then a little bit of viscoelastic under the pupil margin. You could use anything, HPMC. If you have sodium hyaluronate, that's better. But HPMC works as well. So if the pupil is smaller than 4 millimeters, I would recommend for whatever device you use, use a bit of controlled bimanual stretch. Because especially if they are a rigid pupil, that would give you a cosmetically good pupil, because the purpose of using a pupil expander is not to tear that sphincter, but to keep that pupil in an expanded state so it does not come down. So let the tearing be done in a controlled manner So how do you differentiate between a rigid pupil and an elastic pupil? There's a very simple test. Once you've done your paracentesis, before you do your main incision, just inject a little of BSS or ringulactate, whatever you're using, through the side port, and watch for that pupil expansion. See how this works. Done the side ports, and I'm just injecting that BSS over there, and you see that pupil expand. So this is an elastic pupil. This allows you to get that pupil to 5.5 with your pupil expander without damaging the sphincter. This is another case where you have that expansion. Now look at this one. Pseudo-exfoliation. This is not going to budge. It's about 4.5 to 5, but I'm not going to get it more than this. So, and this, of course, it's impossible. So you can inject sodium hyaluronate, you can inject Helon, whatever you want, but it's not going to kind of move. So this needs to be stretched, and we can do a bimanual stretch in a controlled manner so that we have about 4.5 pupil, and then you can use a device, iris hooks, whatever you want. That gives you a cosmetically good pupil the next day. So the take-home message is, unlike the elastic IFS pupil, the rigid pupil is a fibrous ring, and you can't expect a fibrous ring to stretch. So you'll have to tear it. Rigid pupils are better stretched to 4 to 5 millimeters before placing any device. A limited bimanual stretching would produce controlled sphincter tears and give you a cosmetically good result. A bulky pupil expander may stretch the pupil, but will produce uncontrollable tears and is unwieldy. That is a trade-off you must understand. BHEX is not a device which you can use to tear the sphincter. So let's look at this another case with a uveitic eye. So I released the synechiae and then I tried to remove that membrane, and still we could not get that pupil to a size which was good enough for me to use the pupil expander. So we went ahead and did a bimanual stretch. And you will see I'm not stretching it from limbus to limbus or angle to angle. I'm just stretching it to that 5 millimeters so that I don't create a cosmetically bad pupil. And then we go ahead and use the BHEX pupil expander, and we have a fairly good pupil to go ahead and do the phaco surgery, and at the end of the surgery, we would have a nice round pupil. We recommend only the BHEX 23 gauge faucet. It's got a particular design which is ergonomically suited for this device. If you're using the BHEX, I would recommend you to use. I recommend that you use this forceps, and this is how we do it. We tuck. We In the first pass, we take the device and place it on the iris. It's important not to be impatient and tuck the flange in the first pass. You leave it on the iris, and then you start tucking, because if you tuck it in the first pass, if you tuck the first flange, then the device gets into two planes, and that becomes difficult to manage. Fixation of the globe with the side port instrument helps a lot in manipulation, so you have a control, especially if the eye, you can rotate the eye if the side port is not accessible in a deep set eye. Now, the biggest advantage of the B-Hex is in a case where you already have an open capsular excess. So here, what the pupil has come down halfway through in the surgery. Now, using a Mulligan ring or eye ring is very difficult in these situations, because you have a very high chance of engaging the capsular excess margin, and that could be a disaster. So here, with the BX, you just need to inject viscoelastic on that anterior capsular rim, lift off that iris, and as you tuck that flange over there, you have direct visibility of whether you're engaging the capsular margin or not. And when you advance that flange to the periphery, you have instant confirmation that you have not engaged that capsular excess margin. There could be nothing safer than this, and the notches are staring at you. So you cannot, I mean, even if there's, you have face a little resistance, you come back and again disengage and go back. So once you've done that, now you have a comfortable pupil size to deal with the rest of that hard heminucleus. The BX gives you a 5.5 pupil, which is pretty good to do any kind of surgery. Now, it's very important not to dislodge the BX, or for that matter, any pupil expander, while you're doing your manipulation. So remember, chop the nucleus into very small fragments, at least one or two small fragments, so that you have enough room for the rest of the thing to come up. And the trailing haptic, attempt to deliver the entire lens into the bag, especially the trailing haptic. And if you can't do that, there is a way of dealing with it. You push the trailing haptic optic junction in such a manner that the leading haptic optic junction flexes against the equator of the bag, so that this clears the pupil margin without touching the pupil expander or the pupil margin. Otherwise, you're going to dislodge it. That works for any pupil expander. I'll just show you how it's done. So this is just half a minute more, Shodangshu. So that's the trailing haptic goes in one go. That's the best. If you can't do that, this is it. So my trailing haptic is going to be left on the iris, and the standard idea is to push it down. If you push it down, you're going to take that device into the bag, and that's going to get messy. So now what you do is you engage it, and you want to push it, flex it over there, and not actually take support from the, you're not pushing the pupil margin. You clear the pupil margin and then take the trailing haptic down. So you need to be a little fast over here before that trailing haptic kind of completely unfolds. And removal of a pupil expander has never been so easy. Just disengage two notches on either side, and you can just, the trailing notches just disengage spontaneously, and it just walks out of the incision. And it, the best thing is it can be removed through a 1 millimeter side port. And that's how we do it over here. Let's see. We just inject a bit of viscoelastic, hold that with the 23-gauge forceps, and disengage it, like I said, and that's it. You disengage two notches on either side, and you just draw the device out. It walks out through a 1 millimeter. No device in the history of ophthalmology has been able to do that. So if you have a tight situation with IFS, this could be a very wonderful device to use. These are a couple of publications in the IJO, December 2017, and in the Journal of Cataract and Refractive Surgery in 2014. Thank you very much for your attention. Thank you, Shodangshu, for this opportunity. Thank